We talked about linear approximations. Here's the graph of y equals e to the x. And we're just going to restrict that from minus 1 to 1. And calc 1 and calc 2 give this line as the best possible linear approximation for e to the x. And what I notice about this is two things. First is, it's perfect at x equals 0. And as I get further and further away from 0, the approximation gets worse and worse. And second is, it's always an underestimate. What we're in the middle of doing in this class is getting a linear approximation like this. And a couple things I noticed. The first is that the errors are spread out a bit. So in other words, different errors here. So it's going to be perfect here. There's no one error that gets that bad. Things at the edge, we have big errors here. There's no place that has one big error. And if I'm using this line as an approximation several times, I'm going to have some overestimates, I'm going to have some underestimates, and those over and underestimates should cancel each other out. So what class gives this linear approximation?
One on the right.
One on the right?
Yeah, which class?
So this is Calc 1 and Calc 2. What's your superior math class? What math class is that? Linear algebra, yes. The linear algebra, it shows us how we can get a better linear approximation. The idea with linear algebra way to look at things, is imagine that everything is a vector, or as much as you can be a vector. So my space is all the functions. And then my subspace is going to be P1. And I think about my e to the x function as being a vector out here. And the linear algebra way of looking for that linear approximation is what you want to find is that vector in P1 that's closest to the e to the x vector we're trying to approximate. So our approximation, the length of linear algebra, is just the projection of e to the x down to the subspace P1. And I've got a couple ways to find projections. One way to find a projection would be to have a basis for P1. If that was an orthonormal basis, I could calculate the scalar components with a dot product. How about that? I want to build the vector in P1 that's closest to e to the x. So if I had an orthonormal basis for P1, that projection would be built out of the basis elements. I need to scale each one of those. If it's an orthonormal basis, then I've got a trick for finding those scalars. I do it with the dot product. Thank you. had an orthonormal basis for P1, then the way I would find the projection of P to dx onto this space is it's going to be some combination of U1 and U2. And the scalar for U1 is going to be this. And the scalar for U2 is going to be computed with the dot product. So we have to back up for a second. Talking about an orthonormal basis, that means when I do the dot product of these two, I'm going to get zero. The dot product of either of these with itself is going to be one. And I have to calculate a dot product for these scalars. So the first thing we have to do is say, what does it mean to have a dot product for the space of all functions? Now, this is where you can get creative, is you can make up your own version of dot product. The version of dot product I want to make up is that least squares idea. And that's basically that the squares of all these distances is minimized. Intro to linear algebra, I'll always tell you the dot product I'm going to use. So I get to choose the dot product, and I'll tell you one that works. Is later on, when you're using these, it's you could custom design your dot product to help you work with the problem you're doing. And then, a couple things. When we're working with abstract vectors, so instead of just columns of numbers, we don't call it a dot product. What do we call it? So when I say inner product, think it's a special type. It's a non-standard dot product. So I'm doing a dot product type calculation, but it's not the dot product you're used to. And instead of using a dot, we've got another notation we use, angle brackets. So then, so if I'm asking for a linear combination, or sorry, a linear approximation, it's I'm trying to come up with a function that looks like y equals mx plus b. In linear algebra, we say we're trying to come up with an element of P1. If it looks like mx plus b, that's m times x plus b times 1, these are parameters, these are scaling factors to use with these basis elements. So linear algebra way of looking at that problem is P1 is the space that's generated by these two functions. If that was an orthonormal basis, then I could do this trick to figure out what the scaling factors are. So in this case, what it would mean to be an orthonormal basis is the length of each vector would have to be 1, and the two vectors would have to be perpendicular to each other. And each of those statements, length equals 1, can be explained in terms of dot product. Perpendicular to each other can also be explained, or also be described as a dot product. So let's check the first one. So our definition of inner product for this problem, and it'll change problem to problem as I plug it into this. So the inner product of x with itself is this. What do I want the inner product of x with itself to be?
1.
I want it to be 1. Is it 1? What does that tell you about this basis?
It's not.
Okay. One orthonormal basis. This is what has to happen to be an orthonormal basis. It didn't happen, so it's not orthonormal. Do you know the name of the process? Well, do you know the process and what's its name that'll turn any basis into an orthonormal basis? The Gram-Schmidt process. These are all in the notes from Wednesday's lecture. Dot, dot, dot. I think that's what it comes out to. I wanted to get the best linear approximation I could to e to the x. And in the language of linear algebra, is we're finding projection of e to the x onto the space P1. And anything in P1 can be written as a linear combination of basis elements. I made that an orthonormal basis, you've got an easy way to calculate the coefficients.
Sorry, what exactly is that basis?
That's an orthonormal basis for P1. So if I check these three conditions for those vectors, they're all going to be true. We cool? We down to a calculation now? So how do I find this coefficient? I've got an orthonormal basis now. How do I find them?
Can you have us?
That's my boss, yeah. Yes, a dot product, except what do we call it in this?
An inner product.
An inner product, very good. So it's gonna be the inner product of e to the f. And for this problem, how do I calculate an inner product?
Integral.
Yeah, with an integral? Fantasy world us teachers live in, and say, oh, we did that in Calc 2, that's an integration by parts, u is x, dv is e to the x dx. More realistically, though, how do you do that integral?
Look it up.
Exactly. Wolfram Alpha, Symbol Lab. What I want you to believe is that this integral represents some number, and for people smarter than me, figure out that number, it's 0.90. How am I going to find that number? Good, inner product. This time it'll be like e to the x. 1 over square root of 2. And I told you the inner product I want to use. Less. Symbol again. This time it's 1.620. This out. The numbers don't look as good. So the Calc 1 linear approximation is x plus 1. Which looks, I'll grant you, it looks a lot nicer. But if you're actually doing the calculations, this is going to be a better approximation than e to the x than the original one. Let me just mention one thing now. Put this on hold, don't write this down. Oh no. So this you are gonna write down. What I'm about to do is back in your Calc 2 class. Do a Maclaurin series expansion? Have you got this?
The function and then the derivative.
Is it Maclaurin?
Yeah.
Oh, Maclaurin.
Perfect.
Yeah,
okay.
Right.
F of 0, right?
Oh, yeah. And then
F
prime of
0.
Good. F double prime of 0. So, oh, over 2 factors.
Right? Remember this? So the linear algebra way of looking at this is some big basis, 1x, x squared, x cubed. You're trying to write your given function as a linear combination of these basis elements, and calculus taught you one way to generate these coefficients. One thing, I'm going to write it in the linear algebra way. instead of using these as basis elements, in the early 1800s, a mathematician named Fourier said, let's continue to use these words. The idea is, let's use these functions as our basis elements. And a Fourier representation, so write the function as a linear combination of these basis elements, actually does a lot for you. So this was a different class. You can devote an entire semester to just studying these expansions of functions. And if you're doing any sort of engineering, you'll see this. So what would be a good way to calculate these coefficients? Linear algebra, specifically. What would I be doing? Yes, I'd be using an inner product. So what we do is we define for our inner product there'll be a couple homework questions work with this. But the correct inner product for a Fourier analysis is that one. So a lot of times books will say the formula for generating these coefficients and maybe some formula based on this. But because we've had linear algebra, you know what's really going on. And that's, you have an orthonormal basis with this inner product, and the formula for these coefficients is calculating that inner product. And then, I don't think I've written your chapter 5 questions yet. I know in the past I've included questions like this. So what I can do, I can even work in a space like R2, and instead of doing the normal dot product, make a different dot product. So I'm working in R2, and instead of using the normal dot product, this is the dot product that we can do. So I made that up because I want to use it. Figure out the inner product of 1, 2 with 3, 4 for this inner product. So what's the formula? What's x1 times x2? And then x1 times y2? X2, Y1, so 3. Purple. So whatever this is, 3 and 12, and 12 and 8 is 20. Pretty tough. Okay. Let's try this one. Do you remember that we can use a dot product to compute a magnitude?
Yes.
Good. Take the square root of it dotted with itself, and now it's an inner product. Inner product on the spot. It's first I multiply the x's together, and then 3 times the 2 cross products, and then multiply the y's together. So when I multiply the x's together, what do I get?
And you multiply the what?
Multiply the x coordinates. It's 2 plus 3 times 2. Not the standard length, but in this crazy way that I'm using a dot product, I say this as length squared 17. Three times two? So, okay, so first of all, it's these 3 years. So I got 3 x1, y2. So we do x1 times y2 times 3. So I've got 4 terms. First one is these 2 across. Second one is 3 times this diagonal. And then 3 times this diagonal. And then multiply these.
Yeah. It's the same thing you do before.
Oh yeah, this is 1, 2, 3, 4. Here I'm asking for the magnitude of 1, 2. And to compute the magnitude, this is the calculation. So I use the dot product definition again. This time with these 2 factors, rather than 1, 2, and 3. So the way I calculate a length is I do the square root of the vector dotted with itself. So in general, right, this is do the magnitude of the vector is the square root of the vector dotted with itself. Mm-hmm. So first of all, a dot product becomes an inner product. And my vector v is 1, 2. So I'm just going to do 1, 2 by itself here. And my formula for doing this is exactly the definition I had over here. So this tells me how to put 2 vectors together. So I just follow this formula for what's inside here. So in this crazy way of measuring length, this has length squared 17. And then finally, I want to find something perpendicular to this. What does perpendicular mean? Good. It means the dot product is 0. So I want to get a generic x, y, so that when I dot it with 1, 2, I get 0. So help me out here. So do the inner product for this one. What's the first one?
X.
Plus this one. Yeah, it's remember it's three of them.
Or six x.
Six x. So I'm going to get 7x, so it's plus 5y, so 0. And I showed you a trick how to get an x and y, because that was just back in chapter 2. You might not remember it. What's the common denominator of 7 and 5? 35? So if I make one of these a positive 35 and one of these a negative 35, let us throw this out there and see how it works. If x is 5, that makes a 35 and a negative 35. And we're going to be doing that more. So we could parameterize the infinitely many solutions if they only need one. In this weird space, this vector is perpendicular. Make sure you know the definition. So imagine that I've got a big space V, and then I carve out a subspace, I'll call W. Turns out all the vectors perpendicular to W are also going to form a subspace. So V is R2. Yourself, this is a subspace. If I take any two vectors on this line and add them together, it's also on that line. I can scale. It's W perp. And all the vectors perpendicular to this, which in algebra are always y equals negative 2x. Subspace W is the xy plane. What's W perp? What are all the vectors that are perpendicular to the floor?
Z.
Yeah, give me the z-axis, exactly. So, in your homework questions, give me similar to. V is R4. subspace, and what I want to do is find a basis for W total. I know you know how to do this, but I'm not sure if you know that you know how to do this. Do you know how to do this?
Yeah.
So how would you start? Good. So basically, I want to get the dot product. Very good, yeah. And then that's the idea. So what you're going to do is, what's that?
Just turn the vector sideways.
Perfect. That makes sense. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take, like we do for all of these problems, I'm going to take a generic object and figure out what conditions it has to satisfy. So for x, y, z, w to be a w perp, that means it has to be perpendicular to these vectors. Is I can write that as a math expression. And then more importantly is I can write this as a system of equations. Once I've realized there's infinitely many solutions to this system of equations, what am I going to do?
Parameterize
those infinitely many solutions, split them up by parameter, factor out the parameters, and then that will give me the basis of this. Let me talk a little bit more about W. So remember we're doing least square stuff? System of equations that didn't have a solution. And one way to look at the problem is we're looking at the subspace that's the column space of A, and we're trying to build a vector B that's not in the subspace. So what's the best that we can do?
Projection.
Exactly. So the best that we can do is come up with a solution for the projection. And then the key to that idea was having this part. So the idea behind, well, this is called an orthogonal complement. The idea behind a subspace and its perp is any vector in the big space can be written as the sum of two vectors, one from here, one from here. Kind of a way, this is the projection part. If you want to build the original vector, this is the other half. Describe a plane in the algebra or calc 3 way with an equation. And I want you to describe it in the linear algebra way. Describe it with a basis. And now, you know the best type of bases are orthonormal bases. So this is going to be a two-step process. Step one is just going to be to get some basis. And then once I have that basis, how am I going to turn it into an orthonormal basis? Gram-Schmidt experiment. Two steps. Schmidt process to turn it into more of an orthogonal basis. How do you feel about finding a basis for this? Okay. How many solutions does this have? Extract the basis out of the parameterization. There's step one. And then step two is to use the Gram-Schmidt process on the basis you generated.
Can you recall on that Gram distributed process?
Yeah, so Gram Schmidt, that was the one where you started with a V1, V2 basis and converted it to another basis. So your V1 vector was like this. And then what you did is that probably was too long. So you shrunk it down to U1, so you got your U1. So then you imagined you had the U1 here, and V2 was out like this. It's you projected that V2 down to here to make the V2 parallel. Remember this? And then you grabbed the V2 per, and that was probably too long, so you made that short enough. So that was the V2. Another thing that you're going to be asked to do. I'm going to give you the ambient space. In this case, we're working in R3. I'm giving you a plane. I'm giving you a two-dimensional subspace of that three-dimensional space. And then I've got a vector hanging out here. And I want to find the projection of this vector on the W. Okay, you've got two different ways that you can solve that problem. So we know that anything in the space can be written as a combination of basis elements. And if I have an orthonormal basis, it's easy to get the scalars, how far to stretch each of those basis elements before we combine. How do I do it? Yeah, so if I had an orthonormal basis, and I wanted to know the coefficients or know the scalars, use a dot product. So for that trick to work, this needs to be an orthonormal basis. Do you know how to turn an arbitrary basis into an orthonormal basis?
Gram-Schmidt.
is the least squares version that we were talking about earlier. So the second way to solve this problem is to remember when this is impossible, there is a version of this we can solve. We can solve that. Solution to this system of equations. So this means method two. So I'll just walk through the steps here. That's part of R. So this is all this is given. So. So I first set this up as an AX equals B, and the system I want to transfer it into looks like this. What do I do to both sides? Through that process, you'll get an x, you'll get a y. And what that x and y represent are the scalars you need to use for these vectors to generate. Find the solution to AX equals B parallel to find the scalars you need to use for the columns of A to build a projection is you're going to solve this system of equations. So you can set up the system of equations, you can solve it, and then the numbers that you get here are exactly the scalars you're going to need to build. One of those, it's sort of like to spend two lectures on the idea of finding this problem. I complained again about whether I'm getting 10 units for this class. There's a lot more going on here. not going to be able to give a solution?
Yeah.
What's that? There's a number of different ways we can look at this. Righteous is a matrix. What I'm trying to do, so I guess this line, which in algebra is y equals 2x, I'm thinking about the column space of A. It's every input point I pick here is going to land somewhere on the line y equals 2x. And some point that's off the column space. So what's the best that we can do? Is the best we can do is let's call this our vector B. And if there's B parallel, then there's B parallel. So what's the trick? How do we get, if I set it up as a matrix here, and how do I change that matrix equation into one that's going to help me find the best solution? No. There's another way to do it. Without having that range, is the idea. Okay, before what we do is move this matrix to the other side. You take the inverse. But what's the problem here? It is not invertible, yes. So I just wanted to, this is going to come up in the homework. There's a lot of interesting stuff. So remember, we have to do the AD minus BC. So 5 times 45 is 225 minus 225 the crisscross or the determinant is zero. So there's no inverse there. So what that means is whatever this point is, there's lots of different inputs that give that same function. So this is the basis for the null space of this matrix. Did you see that? If I do this, the null space of this, the column space has dimension 1, so the null space has dimension 1. And this vector is perpendicular to each of those columns. So the null space is 1. And what do we know about the null space? Everything on this line gets mapped to what?
Zero.
The origin, right. So everything here is mapped to the zero. And that's y = 3x is perpendicular to that. So we can think about this as a new coordinate system, is this will be my x hat, that will be my y hat, and then if I look at all the solutions that are going to land me here, infinitely many solutions to that. And every solution to this system of equations can be written in terms of an x hat and a y hat. So every solution is going to be some basic solution here plus something in the null space. So by best, I'll point it out and then I'll tell you what it means. When I have lots of possible solutions, the best one is going to be the one that's closest to 0, 0. It's going to be the one that's in the space that's perpendicular to the null space. So another way to say it is because this matrix was not invertible, that means there's infinitely many solutions to this. The best one of those is going to be the one that's closest to the origin, which is going to be this point right here. So that's going to be the intersection of, so you're going to parameterize these infinitely many solutions, and then you're going to find the one solution that's on this x hat.
So perpendicular to every x hat.
Very good, which means in the null space. Oh, actually, no, I think it's the one where y hat is zero. We're just about the null space as well. It's the one where the y hat is zero. Big picture, and the original system of equations had no solution. The best we can do is to get a solution where we find the vector in the column space that's closest to 5, 0. What we haven't seen before is the vector closest to 5, 0 actually generates infinitely many solutions. Using the null space, and I'll go say here, the column space of the transpose is you can generate a new coordinate system. And you represent the line that gives you all solutions to the closest vector here. And one of those is going to be the most special solution, which is that one.
So is the fact that it's the column space of the transpose as well as like the null space, is that significant?
Yeah, absolutely, that's significant. So let me show you what's going on here. So this is the null space of A. This is the column space of A transpose. This is the column space of A. And if we make this an x hat in this space, then your orthogonal complement of this, this is all this stuff, is this new axis is the null space of A transpose. So what you have is you have a coordinate system for the input space, a coordinate system for the output space. Every vector in the output space can be written as a linear combination of something in the column space and of something in the null space of A transpose. And the best you can do is basically give it a vector, break it into these components, and then you just want the part along that new x-axis. And that's essentially a deeper version of the fundamental theorem of linear algebra. Are you guys interested in this? Do you want me to post some papers so we can read through this?
Yeah.
Because I'll try to remember to do it. If I don't, shoot me an email.
Just curious. What is the application of this in a real life situation?
I know it's so specific.
Yeah, how can I say this? So in general, this idea, so abstract this about three levels. When you're doing calculus, so when you're finding the antiderivatives, you're trying to find a function whose derivative is this. So what you do, what's the null space of derivatives? So I think
constant.
Yeah, the constant functions. So I think about, so I've got an operation here that's a derivative. When I want to go back to the original function, it's going to be written as the sum of two special things. One thing in the column space, which is this f, and something in the null space, which is this c. And then when you get into differential equations, anybody? Yeah. Okay, are you digging it? Remember the UC method? So you've got y double prime plus y prime minus 2y is sine x or something like this?
It's a second order
homogeneous. Yeah, very good. Oh, no, this is non-homogeneous. So first you solve the homogeneous part. No, you're right. So first you solve the homogeneous part. And what essentially you're doing is you're trying to find something in the kernel or the null space of this transformation. And then when you find that specific solution, that y sub p, that's just finding one thing in the column space over here. So this idea that any solution over here can be broken down into the sum of something in the column space and something in the null space, in differential equations, comes down to the null space is the solution here. And the column space one is what you get by the UC method. So just that general idea, if you can break anything down into a null space part and a column space part, it comes up all the time.
It kind of makes sense to me, but it's kind of like...
I know, there's a lot going on here. And if I could do this the right way, we'd have about two lectures and then really go into this. I'm going to leave it here, and I'll post that paper if you want to read more about it. that good in chapter 5. Feel free to start the homework, and if you have any questions about the homework, either ask me in class or office hours. My goal is to do chapter 6 as quickly as possible. I don't think I can do it in 4 minutes. Tell you an idea. Yeah, those are great.
They're so good.
I'm like, we want to.
Very good. Yeah. Yeah. I think he's able to make a living now.
I'm sure he did.
I have a bunch of series.
He probably does. He got
so this is like a kind of a breakdown of the monogram process. Because, well, no, I mean, like, because, so this is not, it's not using the same thing. You're finding something perpendicular in the space. But like with your transpose, does it, like, I still don't understand what you're doing with your exhaler and what happens.
Oh, so what it is I've got an input space and an output space. So I've got a matrix A that takes inputs to outputs. And I, and again, this could be much bigger. It's all the possible outputs are going to land in the image A. So I'll just go, I'll finish the lecture just talking about this. Yeah, no worries. It's a lot of inputs together. Then, it's, if I go over here, I know the null space of A is all the inputs that land me to zero. That land me to zero. That A will take the step which is null space. So what I can do is I can look at each of these as the start of a coordinate system. Call it X system. And when we're building a coordinate system, we want an x-axis and we want a y-axis. And just the way I drew this, that was the best possible way. Well, it turns out that there's a nice way to get these y-axes is, and it shouldn't be too hard to see, is what's perpendicular to the null space of A is the column space of A transpose. And what's perpendicular to the column space of A is the null space of A transpose. So what least squares does for us, if I'm trying to solve an AX equals B, I've got my B vector out here like this. And because I have this coordinate system, is I can decompose the B into the B hat and the B. So this tells me that I want to find some input over here that lands there. Now it turns out that everything that lands here is going to be something that's parallel to the null space. So all the solutions to this are going to be represented by a line. So every solution can be represented by one particular vector in the x direction. And then, so I pick. So all of these vectors are solutions to that. And everything on this line is go out along this axis and then go as far as you want in the direction of the null space. So the standard picture is like this. Input space, output space. You've got a target B here. You break B up into its parallel and perpendicular parts. And then you've got an X vector here that you want to send to be parallel. And there's going to be one vector, one particular vector in the column space that does it, plus any vector. So this is an XP. This is a generic vector of null space. So given the B, split it into these components, you can solve this. All the solutions to this are going to be one particular solution. We can pick out which particular solution it is. all the solutions would be one particular solution plus everything plus by the same. So it's a good framework, I always thought. But it's a really good framework, and you're going to see this idea. You've seen it once already, the antiderivatives, then plus C. But plus C is something that represents a generic polynomial. When you get the differential equations, you're going to find a particular solution plus a generic solution to the differential problem. Okay, so I'm going to hang out here. I'll be talking about math. Oh, and I'm not going to make my